Good morning. And welcome to Mount Sylvan. So good to have all of you here this morning as we've gathered on this sacred day to give our thanks and praise to our living Lord, Jesus Christ. Today is Pentecost, so I should also say happy birthday, church, as we remember the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon believers and the birth of the Christian church. Thank you to all of you who are wearing red this morning. I looked out and just saw so much red as we celebrate this special day. This year, Pentecost also falls on Memorial Day weekend, when we also remember the men and women in our nation's military who've made the ultimate sacrifice of their lives in service to America and have protected our homeland and defended the freedom and the values that are so precious to us. I invite you to please join us tomorrow morning at 9:30. We've made the call to go ahead and have the Memorial Day service here in the sanctuary due to the wet weather and the soggy grounds. We'll meet here in the sanctuary instead at 9:30. At this time, I just want to pause for just a few moments to remember and to offer a prayer, but let's pause in silence for just a few moments to give thanks for our fallen sisters and brothers. Let us pray. Oh Lord, we do thank you for the bravery, the dedication, the sacrifices of the men and women in our nation's military who've died in the line of duty. May we never take our freedom for granted. May we never forget what it cost others that we might enjoy the quality of life that we have in the greatest nation on earth. We pray for their families. We pray for our country. We pray for all members of our military, past and present. And we pray for peace. As followers of the Prince of Peace, we pray for peace. In Jesus' name, amen. I do have one final announcement for you. Please continue your prayers for the family and friends of Sue Van Rood. Sue passed away, as you know, on May the 18th at Traburn Nursing Home, and her memorial service to remember and celebrate her life will be here at the church a week from Friday. So that'll be Friday, June the 9th at 11 a.m. So we hope that you'll be able to come out as we remember and celebrate Sue's life. And a thank you to all of you who reached out and cared for her and supported her during her years over at Traburn. Once again, we welcome you, all of our faithful members and those who might be visiting with us this morning. Thank you for choosing Mount Sylvan as we give thanks and we lift up the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Our opening scripture, if we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit, from Galatians 5 this morning. Once again, let's bow our heads in prayer. Oh God, the Holy Spirit, come to us and among us. Come as the wind and cleanse us. Come as the fire and burn away the dross. Come as the refreshing dew and quench our thirst. Convict, convert, and consecrate our hearts. Consecrate our hearts and our lives to our greater good and to thy greater glory. We ask this in Jesus' name, as we join together now for the call to worship. And I invite you to please stand if you are able to do so. The Lord heard our plea and through Christ sent a helper, an advocate, one who is our guide and the reminder of all Jesus taught us, one who is present in all that we do and wherever we go, one who bears witness of the resurrection and the promise of eternity. The Holy Spirit has come that we might have abundant life and that we might know the Lord, worship him, follow his truth, and love one another. Blessed is the name of the Lord, the one who has claimed us as his own. Amen. Our opening hymn is God of Grace and God of Glory. Let us remain standing as we sing together.
Glory.
The peace of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, be with you.
And also with you.
Let us welcome one another in his holy name. As we make our way back to our pews, please remain standing for our affirmation of faith. Today we'll share together in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Congregation may be seated, and we invite our children to come forward for the children's time with Miss Heather.
Good morning. So on a hot summer day, an electric fan can really help keep us cool, right? Yes. How does a fan help keep us cool? How does it keep us cool? Yes, the fan blows the coldness so you don't suffer from hotness. That's exactly what I was gonna say. So good, yeah. So it keeps us cool by blowing the air. So I have a fan that I brought with me. Okay, so I'm gonna turn this on. It is. Oh, do you see it? So do you see the air coming out of the fan? No, well if we can't see the air, then how do we know the fan's working? You feel it, yeah. So one way we can tell that the fan is working is I've tied these bright, colorful things on it, the streamers, so we can see them moving. Another way we know is that we can feel the air, just like you said. And finally, we know the air is working, the fan is working, because we can hear it. Shh, I can Can you hear it? Listen. Sounds like the ocean. Oh, that's pretty peaceful, huh? Well, today, I'm going to turn this down so we can hear our story. So today is a special day which many churches celebrate, and it's called the Day of Pentecost. And here's the story of how it all began. The Bible tells us that on the day of Pentecost, Jesus' followers were all gathered together in one place, and God sent the Holy Spirit to give them the power to teach others about Jesus. Now, they couldn't see the Holy Spirit, so how did they know that this Holy Spirit was there? Well, the Bible says that they knew the Holy Spirit was there because they could hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind coming from heaven. They couldn't see the Holy Spirit, but they could hear the sound of the wind just as we can hear the air blowing from the fan. Then the Bible tells us that they saw what seemed to be flaming tongues of fire that came and rested on their heads. They couldn't see the Holy Spirit, but they knew that the Holy Spirit was there because they could see the flaming tongues of fire just as we see the red and yellow and orange streamers on our fan. Finally, the Bible tells us that they knew the Holy Spirit was there because they could feel His power. When they were filled with the Holy Spirit, He gave them the ability to speak in languages they didn't even know, so that they could tell everyone about Jesus. They couldn't see the Holy Spirit, but they could feel His power in their life, just as we could feel the air from the fan. So the Holy Spirit is still with us today. We can't see Him, but we can hear Him as He speaks to our hearts. We can see His moving in our life, and we can feel the power of His presence as He guides us through each day. That's pretty special. All right, will you pray with me? Dear Father, thank You for sending Your Holy Spirit to be our teacher and guide us. Help us to listen and obey as He teaches us how to tell others about Jesus. Amen. Now, I have, because it is a celebration, what would a celebration be without some streamers? Here you go. So this, as you wave it around, can remind you of our story and how the Holy Spirit is all around us. Would you like one too?
As our children receive their streamers and make their way back to their pews, we're going to sing together, Spirit of the Living God, and you may remain seated as we sing this morning. Thank you, Ms. Heather.
Spirit of the Living God, all the fresh are we. from pettiness, selfishness, and worldly distractions,
we pray, that we might be fully awake, watching for, searching for, and waiting for your Spirit's leading. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Ever-present Lord, through your Spirit's presence, speak to our deepest hurts and our most broken places. Assure us once more of your unconditional love and pardon. On Pentecost and always, may we proclaim the joy of the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven and we are granted new life. Thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, as we remember our prayer concerns this week and moving forward, we ask that you would remember George and Kay Tilley. George is anticipating a cardiac procedure on Tuesday at Duke. Joan Stubbs, and we're told that Joan will start a new round of therapy within the next week or two. Everett Pace's son-in-law, Tony Cobb, is recovering from partial knee surgery this week. Bernice Roffler, who's the mother of Rick Ebersol. Bernice had surgery in Florida on Thursday related to possible colon cancer, so we of course want to remember her in our prayers. Walter Young, recovering from an outpatient procedure this week. Chance Carver, who's the son of Robin Carver, had spinal surgery at Duke on May 26th. Terry Rhodes is ongoing recovery. Mike Brooks, who is recovering at home, and we ask that you would remember both Mike and Carolyn in your prayers. Deborah Goak, as she prepares for her hip replacement on June 26th. And all families whose sons and daughters have sacrificed their lives for our freedom while serving in our nation's military. We ask that you would remember all those veterans and active military personnel and pray for peace here and around the world so that we may know war no more. Would you join me in prayer? Loving God, we rejoice on this birthday of the Christian Church. Your Holy Spirit has brought this family of believers through the centuries and sealed us as members of your everlasting family. Today, we lift up our worries, hopes, and fears, knowing you are here among us, helping us to overcome our struggles and to accomplish your will. O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, give us the wisdom and strength to continually shine your light into places of hurt and desperation. Show us how to offer better care and compassion to the mourning, the sick, the poor, and the lost. May your Spirit rain down upon us as we lift up these concerns. Hear our prayers. Friends, let's join together in praying as our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Now I invite the ushers to come forward so we may share our tithes and offerings.
wake up to find the power and comfort of God's hand in mine. Season by season, I watch him amazed in all of the mystery of his perfect ways. All I have need of, his hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. Trial or pain, he did not recycle to bring me gain. I can't remember one single regret in serving God only and trying his hand. All I have need of, his hand will provide. He's always been faithful to me. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father.
Sing with me.
Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Now this is my anthem, and this is my song, the theme of the stories I've heard for so long. God has been faithful, he will be again. His loving compassion, it knows no end. All I have need of, his hand. He's always been faithful to me. He's always been faithful. He's always been faithful to me.
Thank you.
us pray. Compassionate and generous God, through your spirit of truth and grace, teach us how to share ourselves, our resources, and our service as continual thank offerings unto thee. Through Jesus our Savior, we dedicate these gifts. Amen. The congregation may be seated.
We have two scripture lessons to share as we celebrate this day of Pentecost. The first is from Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, where he talks about spiritual gifts. If you're lucky enough to be one of the ones that have flames on a stick, listen closely when you hear me say the word tongues. Go ahead and wave it. The epistle lesson is 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 3 through 15. The Apostle Paul writes, "Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, 'Let Jesus be cursed,' and no one can say, 'Jesus is Lord,' except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of the knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the discernment of spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in the one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free. And we were all made to drink of one Spirit. Indeed, the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot would say, 'Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body,' that would not make it any less a part of the body." This ends the epistle reading. We now turn to Acts chapter 2, where we hear the details of the arrival of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. The New Testament lesson is Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 8, and verses 12 through 21. When the day of Pentecost had come, they, the disciples, were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as of fire, appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered, because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language?" All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. 'In the last days it will be, God declares, and I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon my slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoke mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness, and the moon to blood, before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day, then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. This concludes the New Testament reading. Today's anthem is entitled, Speak, O Lord.
Thank you, choir, and thank you, Bill. And Jane, thank you for your beautiful anthem earlier as well. We are blessed with the gift of music in this holy place. We turn now to our gospel lesson from John chapter 7 and also some verses from John 14 this morning. And I invite you, if you're able, to please stand for the gospel reading. On the last day of the festival, the great day, while Jesus was standing there, he cried out, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me, and let the one who believes in me drink. As the scripture has said, out of the believer's heart shall flow rivers of living water." Now he said this about the Spirit, which believers in him were to receive, for as yet there was no Spirit, because Jesus was not yet glorified. And then Jesus continued with the promise of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him," he said, "because he abides with you and he will be in you." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Once again, let us pray. Almighty God, may the words of my mouth, may the thoughts and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight. We do pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, our Savior, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. As we shared several times this morning already, today is Pentecost Sunday, the start, the birthday of the Christian church. And this event is recorded in the details in the second chapter of Acts that Thomas shared a little earlier. The Holy Spirit that Jesus promised arrives in full force upon the disciples, like a rush of mighty wind, the scriptures say, and like flaming tongues of fire resting upon each one of them. The scriptures tell us they were all filled, overflowing with God's Holy Spirit. And then they began to speak in other languages. Even more importantly, they were able to also hear and understand God's word, as well as hear and understand one another's words. There in Jerusalem, about 50 days after our Lord's resurrection from the dead, the same disciples who part of that time had been hiding away in fear are now sent out into the streets by the Holy Spirit with a word of life and hope for the people all around them. And they work their way into the crowds and are empowered to overcome barriers of language and nationality and religious background. And they touch the hearts and the minds of many who are gathered from all over the empire, so much so that more than 3,000 profess faith in Jesus Christ as Lord that very day. If we were to go on to read the rest of Acts 2, over 3,000 profess faith in Christ as Lord on that very day together. You know, when the Holy Spirit arrives, Peter reminds those who are confused, those who are bewildered, what's happening. He says this is not only what Jesus promised before he ascended into heaven, but also the fulfillment of God's promises through the prophets of old. Prophets like Joel, who he quotes this morning, along with dozens of other prophecies in Genesis and Malachi and Zechariah and Isaiah, from Job and from many of the Psalms. The scriptures of old, the promises of generation after generation, are fulfilled in their sight on the day of Pentecost. In particular, the Joel passage that the Apostle Peter cites in the sermon reminds God's people that when the Spirit comes upon us and begins to guide our lives, that means that God is placed in control and we begin to turn over control. God is in control and we begin to turn over control. Our sons and daughters will prophesy, the young will see holy visions, the elderly will dream new dreams, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. What a promise. What a promise of transformation, a promise of assurance, a promise of God's provision, as Jane sang about this morning, a promise of salvation for all believers. But if we're honest, and we think about it on this day of Pentecost, nearly 2,000 years later, the Holy Spirit remains such a mystery for us, so misunderstood in many ways, of all the ways that God makes God's self known. To some degree, we can at least wrap our heads around God, our Father and Creator, and God the Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. But the Holy Spirit, what do we say about the Holy Spirit? The breath of God, the refining fire of God, the advocating, comforting, sustaining presence of God with us. That's often another matter for us to try to figure out in modern day America. And so this morning, that's what I want to spend our time on, thinking about God's Holy Spirit. What does the Holy Spirit mean to us in our day and time with the challenges we face in 2023? To do so, I'm going to share several truths with you about the role of the Holy Spirit in the lives of believers. And the first truth is to understand the Holy Spirit's role as God's abiding presence with us. We see that in the scriptures quite often. God's abiding presence with us now and always. And so that means on your loneliest day, you are not alone. On your most frightening, anxiety-filled day, you are not alone. On your most broken-hearted, painful day, you are not alone. The Holy Spirit, God's continual, abiding presence with you and me, is with us, transforming, strengthening, nudging, sanctifying, renewing us. That strength and power that comes outside of ourselves, provided by God, that we might face anything that comes to us in this life. To better understand this, I want to share a Pentecost story. It's a modern day story told by religious writer Parker Palmer about a day when he was forever transformed by God's Holy Spirit. It was some years ago when Palmer was a passenger on a crowded airplane bound for Denver, Colorado. And the plane to Denver pulled away from the gate, but then to everyone's surprise, it taxied to a remote corner of the airfield, and then the plane suddenly stopped. And the passengers all began to feel anxious and afraid. Some of you may have experienced such feelings of flying. If you feel fear and panic at times when you're flying, if you fly for work or vacation regularly, and the plane stops and you look out the window and you see it's not where it's supposed to be, and your heart sinks and your mind goes in 1,000 directions about what could be wrong. You might wonder when the plane stops, is the engine on fire? Is there a threatening person on board? What unseen danger is lurking? And Palmer admits he was having those very kinds of thoughts when the pilot turned on the intercom and he spoke these words. The pilot said, "I have some bad news and I have some really bad news." "The bad news is there's a terrible storm in the west. The Denver airport is shut down. We've looked at alternatives, but we're going to be here through lunch and a few more hours beyond that. That is the bad news. Perhaps we'll get there by early or mid-afternoon." "And then the really bad news," he said, "there's no food on board." "And soon it will be lunchtime while you're sitting here waiting." And so everybody groaned. Passengers started to complain. Some got quite upset and angry. And then Palmer said one of the flight attendants had an idea. She did something quite unusual. She stood up, she took the microphone and said, "We're really sorry. We didn't plan for things to turn out this way. To be honest, the crew can't really do a whole lot about it by ourselves. I know for some of you it's a really big deal. You might have a medical condition and you need to eat lunch to take medication. You might have blood sugar issues. So I tell you what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna take these couple of baskets I have. I'm gonna pass them around. And I want everybody to put at least one thing in the basket. Some of you brought a little snack along. I know you did to tide you over," she said. "Peanut butter crackers, maybe candy bars, maybe a few lifesavers that you can share. And if you don't have anything edible," she said, "just drop in a notepad or drop in your business card or maybe the magazine you're reading. Everybody can put something in the basket. And then we're going to reverse the process," she said. "We'll pass the baskets back out again, and each person can take what he or she needs." And Palmer said what happened next was miraculous. The griping stopped. The fear subsided. The panic began to dissipate. And the calming presence of the Holy Spirit overcame each one of us. People started to root around in their pockets and in their handbags to find something to share with their neighbor. Some got up and opened suitcases from the overhead luggage rack, and they took out boxes of chocolate, a salami, crackers, even a huge bottle of apple juice, he said. People began to laugh and talk and share. All because one person with the right spirit reminded us, he said, of a truth and power beyond ourselves, of the great provider who was already with us. He added, the Holy Spirit transformed this group who'd been solely focused on their own needs into a community of sharing and celebration. The Holy Spirit transformed our self-focused scarcity into a kind of others-focused abundance. The people remembered what they already had. What a powerful story. And after the flight, he said, it eventually proceeded to Denver. He said, as he stopped on his way off the plane and he asked the stewardess, he said, do you know, there's a story in the Bible about what you did back there. And she smiled and said, yes, that's why I did it. But isn't that really what the whole Bible is about anyway? God is with us. God will provide. God will save his children. On this birthday of the church, I want to ask you if you'll repeat those three after me. God is with us. God will provide. And God will save his children. My friends, what happened 2 millennia ago on Pentecost was the very same thing. The disciples were all afraid. They'd been hiding out. They were disillusioned over the crucifixion of Jesus, their leader and their Lord. And then they were all transformed on that day by the Holy Spirit. From a people that were focused on themselves and their fear and their deprivation, they were transformed into a community of sharing, of celebration, of Holy Spirit power. And they spread that life-saving resurrection news of Jesus Christ throughout the world. It was the beginning of the Christian church and how we are to love and to share and to witness the same good news, the same Holy Spirit that we Christians continue to claim and proclaim 2,000 years later. The church founded on the risen Jesus Christ and the church raised up by the Holy Spirit of the living God. Sisters and brothers, of all these lessons of the first Pentecost, on that great birthday of the Christian church of which you and I are a part of all those lessons, perhaps the biggest one for us to learn again is what the airplane attendant taught that hungry, anxious crowd on a plane years ago, which is to stop and remember what we already have. One of the worst sins of 2023, forgetting what we already have. In times of change, in times of challenge, in times when we don't know which way to turn, we already have God's Holy Spirit here and now abiding with us if we call upon him for wisdom and guidance and strength. Wouldn't that be something, this Pentecost, if we remembered what power we already have with us? A power that can overcome all things through the one who strengthens us, as the Apostle Paul says in Philippians 4:13. A power that can overcome all things through the one who strengthens us. Wouldn't it be something if we let the Holy Spirit lead our lives in that way? Our words, our actions, our days. Surely then our sons and daughters would prophesy. Our young would see visions. Our elderly would dream new dreams. And everyone who called on the name of Jesus Christ would be saved. Let's pray about that together. Oh Lord, this Pentecost, we pray for a new awareness of your presence, of your power, and of your peace with us. Through the Holy Spirit, remind us we are forgiven, we are loved. Remind us you will supply the resources we need to find our way through this difficult time in the world. Help us remember that all we have needed, your hand has provided, as we heard earlier this morning in song. For we are your children, and you've stopped at nothing to save us. And so no matter what we face this day, Help us remember you are with us and you are more than enough to carry us through. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is Forward Through the Ages, a wonderful hymn to remind us of the mission of the church. Let us stand and sing with joy. Again, what a joy to worship together on this Pentecost Sunday. I give thanks for Lee Rodeo for all of his help with the service this day, for the beautiful music, and each person who's taken part of it. Now go forth in all things. May the love of the Father and the saving grace of Jesus the Son and the power of the Holy Spirit keep you and guide you. May we go forth to be a blessing to others. May we go forth to be peacemakers. May we go change the world. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen.